Okay, good morning everyone. Let us start our class today with the Hollywood movie I Am Legend. So did anyone watch this movie? What is the cast of this movie? What's the role played by the different scientists? So actually in the year 2009 they plan to find a treatment for the cancer. So the patient suffering from the cancer, right now we have surgical treatment, radiotherapy, chemotherapy in the advanced stages. But what did this scientist do in the year 2009? They manufactured a genetically engineered measles virus. They re-engineered measles virus. Originally, they thought that it would be a cure for the cancer, and it was used for the treatment of the cancer. They could see that there was a wonderful response to the patients. They were recovering from the cancer. But at the same end, what happened? This virus killed about 90% of the world's population, turns 9.8 into vampire. Most of the human, with the mankind, was swapped out. It was about 90% of the population was swiped out because of this measles virus. And the human being were turning into vampires. They were more active, and they were dependent on human blood for their survival, and they were extremely sensitive for the ultraviolet rays, and they were called as dark seekers. So this was the thing that has happened as a part of the movie. And about 0.2% of the population were immune to the virus, and people who were immune to the virus, from there the plasma was taken from those patients and it was injected for the people who were affected with this virus. That's about the movie aspect of the thing. And today we are going to discuss about the biochemistry of the cancer, and ultimately they didn't find any cure for the cancer. Now lot of research trials have been going on to target cancer, to make it reversible, and still the things are on the streamline. Let's see what happens in the future. So today we'll be dealing with the biochemistry of cancer. Most of the questions are asked for the short notes or short answer in this topic. And please do concentrate on this particular topic. Cancer is nothing but cancrum. It's a Latin word, and in the Greek it is called carcinoma. In Sanskrit it is called as karkitakam. It means crab, because the veins are swollen around the area of the cancer in the human body. Henceforth, it resembles like a crab, glimpse of the crab. That's why it was labeled or named as karkitakam. And UICC, it's a cancer organization which has defined cancer as a disturbance of growth caused by excessive proliferation of cells without apparent relation to the physical demands of the organ involved. Please give attention to each and every word that is described here. Disturbance of the growth, which is caused by excessive proliferation of the cells. Actually, there is no requirement for the excessive proliferation, but in a patient suffering from cancer, there is excessive proliferation, there is without apparent relation to the physical demands of the organ involved. Oncology mainly deals with the etiology, diagnosis, treatment, prevention, and the research aspects of the cancer. Now, coming to the most commonest cancers in males and females across the world and India. In India, the cancers in the male, the oral cancer accounts for about 30%, because most of the people are having tobacco chewing habits in our country. And pharyngeal cancer accounting for 10%, and esophageal cancer accounting for 6%. This is with respect to males in India. In the developed countries, the lung and colon cancer accounting for 30% of the, described about the colorectal cancer, their prevalence in Western countries and all. We have discussed about it in nutrition chapter, right? And rectal cancer 25%, and the oral cancer accounts for 2% across the world, especially the developed countries. In females, in India, cervical cancer accounting for 30% of the population, and oral cancer 18%, breast cancer 16%. And in developed countries, the breast cancer overtakes cervical cancer, which is about 20%, rectal cancer 25%, and the cervical cancer 10%. This is about the various prevalences of the various cancers across India and world. Again, etiology of the cancer, it is multifactorial. They can be physical causes, chemical causes, metabolic, hormonal, environmental factors. Sometimes it is just without any reason. There is a spontaneous cancer because of the errors in the DNA. It is at the level of the genetic level. Okay, there may be errors in the replication, errors in the transcription, translation. The DNA repair mechanisms are defective in such patients who are unable to, you know, we have already discussed about various DNA repair mechanisms, various defects that is happening at the DNA level. And advanced, definitely they say that cancer is a disease of the old age, because certain mutations are already present in our body, but as the age advances, all these mutations come accumulated in a cell and there's going to produce what is called as cancer. And the second, the cancer accounts for the second commonest cause of death across the world, next to cardiovascular deaths. The first and foremost cause of death is cardiovascular death, and the second will be the cancer. And the physical, chemical, oncogenic viruses we'll discuss. Already we have discussed in a chapter called mutations, when we were talking about mutations, we have already discussed about the physical agent, the ultraviolet B rays, which is going to cause what? What is the mechanism of ultraviolet B rays? How does they cause damage to the DNA? By, yeah, can you text me? By the formation of pyrimidine dimers. And ultraviolet A is going to induce free radical damage to the DNA. And ionizing radiation, they cause irreversible and irreparable damage to the DNA. Elevated temperature again causes depurination, depyrimidation, that is hydrolytic layer reactions, and is going to damage the DNA. And the chemical agents, how do they enter into our body? It may be via the diet, or it may be via lifestyle and occupation. Diet, mainly the people who are consuming much, you know, aflatoxin. They are the toxins called as aflatoxins, which are present in the fungus, especially the Aspergillus flavus. This is going to enter our body via the diet. Occupation, the person, the workers who are engaged in aniline dye industry, they are exposed directly to certain chemicals, and the chemical is going to enter their body by ingestion or by inhalation. So this occupational exposure is also very common. The other thing, some people, you know, have a lifestyle like smoking is some people's, it's a posh habit. People who smoke are at an increased risk of, especially the lung cancer. The classification of chemical mutagens are, they are classified into polyaromatic hydrocarbons, which include benzopyrenes and chloranthenes and DMPV, that's a dimethyl benzandrosine, and aromatic amines like MAP and nitrosamines like dimethyl nitrosamine, natural chemicals like aflatoxins, which are derived from the Aspergillus flavus. Can you see the aflatoxins which are present on the, these are nothing but the molds which grows on the rice and wheat, and because of the dampened environmental factors, and you can see the corn affected with the aflatoxin, is a fungal infection on the corn, and you know, these are the corn seeds and peanuts, you know, these are the molds which are grown on this kind of food stuff, and they are ingested by the human being, they do enter into our body. And even through the cow's milk, we are able to sometimes, you know, acquire this aflatoxins, because the animals again got infected with this. Then coming to the cigarette smoke, it seems that the WHO has estimated that one cigarette is going to reduce the lifespan of a human being by 10 minutes. So someone wants to quit the smoking, please do look at these statistics. And the 10 cigarettes per day is going to cause lung cancer. They are at risk of 15 times more than a normal person who doesn't smoke. And the person who smokes about 20 cigarettes per day, he is at 40 times risk of developing lung cancer. See the risk. 10 cigarettes, 15 times risk. 20 cigarettes, it's almost double. 40 times they are at risk of developing lung cancer. And your husband who is a smoker, and the wife as a passive smoker, she is at risk of 5 times more compared to the husband. So this is about the, you know, the risk factors of carcinogens that are accounting for the mutagenesis. There's something called anti-mutagens. The agents which are causing, you know, mutation and accounting for damage of DNA for the causation of cancer, we call them as mutagens. And anti-mutagens are the one, the substances or the chemical compounds which are going to prevent the tumor promotion. They are going to interfere with the tumor promotion. They include vitamins. Which are those vitamins? The antioxidant vitamins, namely vitamin A, carotenoids, vitamin E, vitamin C, and certain tubers, beans, green leafy vegetable, the dietary fiber, definitely it is going to prevent colonic cancer. We already studied the importance of dietary fibers in the last class. And curcumin is a chemical compound which is present in the turmeric. You know, turmeric, that the Indian spices, Indian food, mainly we do use on our regular basis the turmeric powder, which is rich in curcumin, which is going to be an anti-chemical cancer agent. And flavonoids, which are again present in certain fruits, and these flavonoids have got anti-tumor properties. And phenolic compounds, which are present in the grapes, they have got a very strong antioxidant property. Thus, they will prevent the damage that is caused by the free radicals. And the green tea, these days there is a fashion in everywhere that every person, whether he's a health worker or non-health worker, they are all engaged in the consumption of the green tea. It has become a fashion these days. Because the green tea is again, definitely it's very protective. It has got a lot of antioxidant properties accounting for the prevention of the cancer. These are some of the effects of the DNA damage that is by DNA undergoing methylation. There may be sometimes transcriptional defect, telomere shortening, microsatellite DNA instability, and DNA histone deacetylation. These are some of the the nuclear effects that is imposed by this ultraviolet ray, cigarette smoke, cellular metabolism, and replication errors. Now, coming to the oncogenic virus. Onco means cancer causing. Okay, these are the cancer causing virus. These are the biological agents which are play an important role in the etiopathogenesis of the cancer. What does the virus do? It is a retroviral. The virus containing cDNA, it's going to bind to the target, the human DNA. It's going to bind to it. It's going to transfer its genome to the human genome, and there's a defect in the DNA repair mechanism, and the virus is going to get inserted into our DNA, and it is going to cause replication. The replication, it is at a very high rate. The cell division is at a very, very high rate. So that's how the viruses account for the causation of the cancer, by causing their genome insertion into our genome. Some of the oncogenic viruses that are affecting the animals include SB40, papilloma virus, Merck. These are the viruses having DNA as a genetic material. They go to target mouse, rabbit, chicken, and they lead to sarcoma, papilloma, lymphoma kind of tumors. And the retrovirus type C, it is a gross virus or ROS virus. They are RNA viruses affecting mouse and avians, and they are going to account for causation of leukemia and sarcoma. Retrovirus type B, it is Bittner form. It's a RNA virus going to affect mouse, and it's going to cause mammary gland tumor. Pertaining to the human being, the Epstein-Barr virus, it is accounting for the causation of Burkitt's lymphoma and nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Again, coming into this particular etiology of Epstein-Barr virus, it is going to infect the cells in three different ways. First of all, the Epstein-Barr virus is going to attack the inflammatory B cells. That is, B lymphocytes are going to be attacked by the virus. Number two, it is going to inoculate its genome into the human genome. It's going to inoculate, or it's going to insert its own genome into our genome. And number three, there is a unarrested growth, or there is excessive cell division accounting for the malignant transformation of this normal tissue into the cancerous tissue. This also accounts for nasopharyngeal carcinoma. Then there's another important virus called human papilloma virus, which is going to be a deadly virus, which is accounting for the causation of uterine. Okay. Hepatitis B virus causes hepatoma, and look at the action or the mechanism of action of human papilloma virus. It is a circular DNA virus. Once it infects one cell, it is penetrated into the human cell. There is a single cell affected over here. Their DNA genome, circular DNA, is inserted into our own DNA, and you can see many cells are infected now. One single virus, one cell got infected first, and in the second stage, there are many cells got affected. Once the many cells are carrying this virus genetic material in them, there is a unarrested cell growth, and the basal layer is going to be damaged, and you can see the cells coming out of the basal layer. Okay, so there is a malignant transformation of these cells. So this is how the HPV and the host interaction takes place. Now coming to the oncogenes. Again, this is an important question. It is most commonly asked for short answers are short notes. Oncogenes means genes which are causing causing cancer. There is a difference between oncogenes and oncogenes. Please do notice the spelling. Oncogenes are genes which are going to cause cancer. Oncogenes, after G-E-N, Yes, there is no E in it. Oncogens are mutagenic agents like physical, chemical, biological agents. They are oncogens and these are oncogenes. A definitive evidence says that how is it identified for the first time? Yes, so there are cancer-causing genes in our body as well. The normal human being also contains a cancer-causing genes in us. But given the active stimulus, they perform their function. If there is no stimulus, the oncogen gets suppressed. Getting my point? It's a Ross sarcoma virus. It was the first, the oncogene was first time demonstrated in RSV virus. It produces sarcoma in events, birds. It causes sarcoma. The gene was labeled as SRC gene. The same gene sequences were also present in the avian cells. The same virus, the genome, the gene sequences, the nucleotide base pairing, same similar sequences were also present in the avians. That is how they got to conclusion that yes, there are oncogenes present in the normal cells as well. This fact reveals that the normal cells also contain DNA sequences which are similar to that of viral oncogenes. Now, to differentiate whether it is a viral or cellular, it is labeled as VSRC, it is viral SRC, and if it is cellular, it is labeled as CSRC. These oncogenes which are present in the normal cells, they are in an inactive form. They are not in the active form. I told you, given the appropriate stimulus, the proto-oncogenes will be converted into oncogenes resulting in the causation of cancer. Actually, they are in the inactivated forms. In humans, about greater than 100 proto-oncogenes are known till date. Look at the number of proto-oncogenes that are present, and we are risk of so many cancers. Into the various oncogenes, ABL, it is located on human chromosome number 9. And the virus carrying the gene is Abelson leukemia virus in mouse. And the remember one thing, that all the oncogenes do exhibit their property of causing cancer by the production of certain protein factors or the growth factors, without which they cannot act. They are going to produce some growth factors which is going to cause excessive growth of a cell. So this ABL gene is going to promote tyrosine kinase enzyme, which is located in the plasma membrane. Next, RB. ERB, capital B. It is located on human chromosome number 7. The virus carrying the gene is erythroblastosis virus in chicken. It acts as a receptor for the epidermal growth factor. Once this is stimulated, there will be unlimited growth of this epidermal cells, right? Resulting in metastatic growth in turn into the cancer. So it is located in the nucleus, and MYC gene. MYC is located on human chromosome number 8. It is called as myelocytoma virus in chicken. It's a DNA binding protein. Again, nucleus. CIS gene. It is located on human chromosome number 22. It is simian sarcoma virus in monkey. It causes stimulation of which factor? Platelet derived growth factor. It is located on the cell membrane. SRC20, it is a Ross sarcoma in chicken. It is going to cause activation of tyrosine kinase and excessive production of tyrosine kinase, which is located on the membrane. Ross12, it is rat sarcoma, which is the mechanism of this particular virus is by GTPase, and it's located in the cytoplasm. So this is about the various oncogenes, and please do remember this table. It may be asked for 5 marks or 3 marks. You should be able to remember at least the ABL, which is the oncogenic product, is tyrosine kinase. ERP2, that is epidermal growth factor. ERP-A, it is a transforming growth factor. MYC gene, DNA binding protein. CIS gene, platelet derived growth factor. And SRC, tyrosine kinase, RAS, GTPase. By inhibiting these growth factors, we can develop the drugs for the treatment of cancers. How does this activation of proto-oncogenes takes place? There is a proto-oncogene already present in our DNA. Right, so genetic material which is present, and sometimes there may be deletion or point mutation in the coding sequences of the DNA or the transcribed mRNA. Once there is a mutation in the coding sequence, what would happen? Hyperactive protein is made in the normal amounts. And regulatory mutation, there is a mutation in the regulatory gene which is functioning as switching on, switching off. If there is a defect at this level, the normal protein greatly gets overproduced. There is a defect here, regulation is not happening, so there is an uncontrolled gene expression. There is an excessive production of the protein which is pertaining to that particular gene deletion or regulatory mutation. Now there is something called gene amplification. There is enormous production of that particular gene which codes for a particular protein. So there is a overproduction of such kind of proteins. Now there may be sometimes chromosomal rearrangements. The nearby regulatory DNA sequences causes normal protein to be overproduced, and sometimes there may be fusion to actively transcribe gene products. Hyperactive fusion protein may result. So any defect at this level can lead to the activation of the proto-oncogenes. Now, once there are proto-oncogenes, then every one of us should have cancer by today. But the incidence is not so high. We have already discussed in the very first slide of our class, right? There are some other genes in our body. The God has given us oncosuppressor genes, which to protect against the cancer-causing agents. These are the genes which are normally protect the individual from developing the cancer. Again, this is a 3-mark important question. And when the gene is deleted or mutated, the cancer results. This oncosuppressor genes, if they undergo any point mutation or frame shift mutation, or they might undergo deletion, in such cases, what will happen? The oncosuppressor genes get suppressed, and there will not be protection of these cancer-causing agents from the damage. Anti-oncogenes are written with the capital letters, and the oncogenes are written with the small letters. We have already seen SRC, MYC gene, they are all written with the small letters. Observe this: ABL, ARPA, RP, MYC gene, CIS gene, SRC gene, RAS gene. Now, the anti-oncogenes or oncosuppressor genes, they are written with the capital letters. Like we have retinoblastoma gene, which is called as RB, located on 13 chromosome. Wilms tumor gene, it's going to protect against the development of Wilms tumor. PAP gene going to protect against the familial adenomatosis polyposis. And DCC gene is going to protect against the colon cancer. And gene for protein P53, that is the abbreviation is P53, familial breast cancer, that is BRCA1 and BRCA2, BRC1 and BRC2. And von Apel Lindau gene, that is VHL gene. So these are some of the examples for the oncosuppressor genes. I already said you, the oncogenes, they exhibit their mechanism of action via the production of something called growth factors. What are these growth factors? How do they act? They cause excessive mitosis and differentiation of the target cells. In fact, they were behaving as a local hormones. They behave as a local hormones. Now, some of the examples of the growth factors are epidermal growth factor. As the name itself indicates, it stimulates epidermal cells and epithelial cells. There is an uncontrolled cell growth. Number two, the transforming growth factor alpha, transforming growth factor beta. Alpha is located or it is produced by tumor cells and placenta, and transforming growth factor beta produced by platelets and placenta. Their function is similar to that of epidermal and growth factor, and whereas transforming growth factor beta has got inhibitory effect on the fibroblast. Platelet derived growth factor, it is produced by the platelets, it accelerates the wound healing. They are normally produced in a cell, right? Accelerates the wound healing. Neuro growth factor, as the name itself indicates, it promotes the growth of the sensory nerves. Insulin-like growth factor, it is causing sulfation into the cartilaginous tissue. Erythropoietin stimulates erythropoiesis. Granulocyte macrophage colony stimulating factor, name itself is indicating, stimulates granulocytes, monocytes, megakaryocytes. Granulocyte colony stimulating factor, it stimulates again granulocytes. Monocyte colony stimulating factor, it's going to stimulate monocytes. Tumor necrosis factor alpha, it's going to cause necrosis of the tumor cells and a proliferation of the leukocyte. These are growth factors and their respective functions. So please do remember about this table. Again, it's very, very important topic in the examination point of view, especially even for the NEET PG as well. Now, what are this tumor cells now? Some of the properties of the cancer cell one must know to understand the basics of the biochemistry of the cancer. Now let's see what is tumor kinetics. Tumor kinetics is that normally in a cell, 1% of the cells are in the dividing phase, only 1%. If it is between the 2 to 5%, we say that there is an increased cell division. Normally 1% of the cells are in the division phase. If it is 2 to 5%, we say it is abnormal. If it is 2% cells are dividing in the active division phase, we say that and the 5% of the cell division indicates that there is an active metastasis that is going on in the tissue. Yet that is about the tumor kinetics. We say that if the 5% of the total cells are in the actively division phase, we say that the tumor is in the aggressive phase. There is a rapid cell division, there is a rapid spread across the tissues, and it may be to the nearest tissues or to the distant tissues causing metastasis. This doubling time. There is a time taken by the tumor cell to double. Suppose there are 400 divisions. It is a time taken by these cancer cell to become 800. The doubling time is almost between 10 to 440, 450 days. The mean division is taken as 100 days for the doubling time for the cancer cells. They say that the literature says that for the cancer cells to get doubled, it takes approximately somewhere about 100 days. But it varies between, depending upon the type of cancer, depending upon the individual host factors, it can vary between 10 days to 450 days. But median we take it as 100 days. Now, what is malignant transformation? That is, whenever the cancer is present in a single, in a particular tissue, it can spread to the nearby tissues or it can go and spread to the distant tissues. Okay? Most commonly, it may spread to the liver. The primary may be somewhere else, but the secondary is we are going to see in case of liver. That is called as malignant transformation. The normal cells will exhibit a phenomenon of single layering, but where the malignant transformation exhibits a phenomenon of multi-layered. These cells are having many, many layers. Means number of cell division is increased, number of cell proliferations have been increased, and there is a multi-layered cells. That is called as malignant transformation. And what is sialic acid addition and chelation, metastasis and secondaries, Warburg hypothesis, and cancer cells are immortal, and there is something called apoptosis which we are going to discuss. The first three we have discussed about tumor kinetics, doubling time and malignant transformation. Look at the picture here. This is about the malignant transformation. This is the intestinal epithelial cells in the culture. The same cells, you can see, they have been transformed and they have changed their shape and size into the different, the same cells got transformed, and there will be spreading of the tumor to the nearest tissues or to the distant tissues undergoing transformation. So that there is no change from the one type of cell to the another type of cell. Now, there's something called contact inhibition. Normally, when two cells, suppose if you make a cut on the skin, there is an abrasion or cut on the skin, the cells will grow from the both the ends. There is a proliferation of cells from the both the ends, and the skin, the cut which was made on the skin has to close. Now, when two cells from the opposite ends come closer, they come in contact with each other. Now, it is a signal that now it has to stop. The cell proliferation has to stop. Otherwise, it will result in excessive growth, right? This contact inhibition property is lost in cancer cells. Getting my point? This contact inhibition is lost. Once this contact inhibition is lost, cells will not have any kind of signal that now it's a time to stop the growth, but they will lead to the excessive growth, excessive proliferation, increase in the number of cells. That is called as contact inhibition, which is disturbed in cancer cell. Look at the picture here. It's a normal cell, low density and high density. This is E-cadherins, that's tight junctions. When they come in contact with each other, still the single layer is maintained. There's a contact inhibition. Look at the cancer cells. There's a mutation or loss of E-cadherins or disturbed cell adhesion. There's a loss of contact inhibition mechanism leading to the excessive growth of the cells. Loss of contact inhibition, cell grow on top of each other. Getting my point? So this is about the contact inhibition characteristic feature of the tumor cells. Chelation. Now tell me which carbohydrate causes chelation. Yes? NaNA, do you remember NaNA? That is N-acetyluraminic acid. It is an example for what kind of sugar? Nanose, 9 carbon containing sugar, right? In carbohydrate chemistry, we have already studied about this particular carbohydrate. This NaNA causes, it will impart negative charges to the NA cell. The speciality of the cancer cells is that it will be having lot many coats of the sialic acid. If you find many sialic acid residues in a cell, definitely is one of the prominent or the classical feature of your cancer cell. you can see so many nano molecules have got attached to the cells. The CLHN is a characteristic feature of the cancer cells because they are giving more negative charges to the cell, which is going to help in the more and more cell proliferation. Now metastasis. What is metastasis? Now there is a primary tumor at this junction. Okay, this primary tumor has entered into the blood vessel. Some of the cells have got intravenated, called as intravasation. These blood cells across the vessels, they will carry to some other organs, called as extravasation. They will affect any organ of their choice. This spreading into other organs. The primary can be somewhere, but the secondary can be in the form of liver cancer. Maybe secondary is in the liver. Getting my point, this is called as metastatic tumor. They are spreading via the blood vessels from the local tumor to the distant metastasis. So this is about the metastasis is a characteristic feature of the cancer cells. Now, something called apoptosis. What is apoptosis? Everyone is aware of it. It is a programmed cell death is called as apoptosis. How does it happen? It is mediated by certain genes. What are those apoptotic genes? Again, this is a short answer question. The apoptotic genes are mainly RB gene and P53 genes. If these genes are present, they are going to signal the cell for the death. Normally, in a cell, number of cells dividing is equal to the number of cells which are dying. Proliferation is equal to the cellular death. How does cellular death happen? It can be by the decreased oxygenation to the cell, or decreased micronutrients to the cell, decreased blood supply to the cell. All these are accounting for the causation of apoptosis. Look at the picture here. This is a P53 mediated apoptosis, and there is a cellular death. But in case of patient suffering from the cancer, there is a deficiency of P53 gene, which is going to signal for the apoptosis. This is defective. Now there is no signal for apoptosis. There is a uncontrolled cell growth. Cell is not going to die. It's going to become immortal. That we call it as cancerous cell. And coming to the tumor markers. Again, this can come for long question. Very, very important question for the examination point of view. What are these tumor markers? Most of you must be aware by now, these tumor markers are highly employed in the clinical practice for picking up the diagnosis of the tumor, or to measure the prognosis, whether the patient is responding to the treatment or not to the particular tumor. So these are called as, they are also called as tumor index substances. Tumor markers are also called as tumor index substances. These are nothing but the factors or the proteins which are released from the tumor cell, which can be detected in the blood. Therefore, they are going to indicate the presence of tumor in the body. The uses are to follow up of a patient suffering from the cancer, number two for the diagnostic aspects and for the prognostic aspect, where we can roughly say whether the patient is going to survive, assess the prognosis of the disease. The conclusion that yes, this person is having tumor. No, we cannot say just with the measurement of the tumor marker, but it needs a supportive evidence in the form of CT, like CT scan, MRI scan, if it is pertaining to the brain, okay, and biopsy. Tissue biopsy is always mandatory for the diagnosis of any cancers. Most commonly, we do get breast cancer, the biopsies are very commonly done in the clinical practice. That means collecting the tissue with the help of a needle and examining it under the microscope with the special stains that we call it as fine needle aspiration biopsy or fine needle aspiration cytology. We are going to stain the cells and examine for any malignant transformation of the cell. Okay. Now, the tumor markers are classified as oncofetal number 1, oncofetal products, number 2, carbohydrate antigens, number 3, tissue antigens, number 4, enzymes as tumor markers, and number 5, hormones and their metabolites as a tumor marker, number 6, tissue catabolic products and serum proteins which could be used as a tumor marker. Now let us look at the example of oncofetal antigens or oncofetal products. There are two markers pertaining to this classification, that is alpha fetoprotein carcinoembryonic antigen. alpha fetoprotein is going to be raised in a patient suffering from hepatoma, that is a benign tumor of the liver, germ cell cancers, and a carcinoembryonic antigen is the diagnostic marker for the diagnosis of colorectal, gastrointestinal, and lung cancer. Now, coming to the alpha fetoprotein, why they are called as oncofetal products. Normally, during the embryonic cell, the embryonic antigens are expressed on the functioning gene, and in the normal adult, they have to suppress. They have to be present only during the fetal life. Once they get into the adult cell, they have to get suppressed. But this gene has to undergo repression once it reaches the adult age. But this gene does not undergo repression. It causes derepression, gets expressed, and it is going to cause embryonal antigen re-expression, and the gene is derepressed, resulting in malignant growth. They have to be present only in the fetal life, but their persistence in the adult life can cause cancer. Now, one of such important tumor marker is alpha fetoprotein, which is going to be raised. Normally, alpha fetoprotein, the concentration should be less than 15 nanogram per liter. Remember, 15 nanogram per liter. If it is greater than 300 nanogram per liter, we take it as a patient is suffering from the germ cell tumor or the hepatomas. Similarly, carcinoembryonic antigen is going to be raised in colorectal, gastrointestinal, and lung cancers. The carbohydrate antigens like CA125, it is a diagnostic marker for the ovarian cancer. Most of the patients who are suffering from the ovarian cancer, even after the treatment, the CA125 levels are measured. The patient undergoes surgical treatment for the excision of the ovarian tumor to monitor whether the persistence of the tissue is still there or not. This particular marker could be used. The gradual decrease or disappearance of this marker will say that the surgery is successful. Tissue antigens like tissue polypeptide antigen is going to be generally in most of the cancer, it is going to reflect the general cancer load. Now certain going to be elevated, like alkaline phosphatase. You know that alkaline phosphatase has got a 6 different isoenzymes. When we studied about isoenzymes chapter, we are well versed with ALP. This ALP is going to be raised in the bone tumors or bone secondaries. Placental type and alkaline phosphate called as Regan ALP, it is going to be raised in lung cancer and a patient suffering from seminomas. Now coming to the prostate acid phosphatase, it is also one of the marker. These days it is less used, but yeah, earlier it was also one of the marker for the diagnosis of the prostate cancer. The most commonly used marker in the today's clinical practice is that prostate specific antigen, that is PSA, for the diagnosis of prostate cancer. Now there are two types of PSA, that is total PSA and free PSA. Normally in the earlier days they were using total PSA as itself alone as a marker for the diagnosis of the prostate cancer. Normally the PSA should be less than 4 nanogram per liter. But in a patient suffering from prostate cancer, these days the free PSA and the total PSA ratios are used. Now these days ratios are the better markers, as you look it in the lipid profile as well. We are not going to consider single LDL value or single HDL value for the risk evaluation of the cardiovascular disease. We are going to always calculate the ratios, that is called as atherogenic indexes, like bad cholesterol divided by good cholesterol, that is total cholesterol to HDL ratio, LDL to the HDL ratio. Similarly, here for the prostate cancer as well, we are going to take free PSA to total PSA ratio. Now, there is another marker called neuron specific enolase, which is going to reflect that the patient is having nervous system tumors. Now, coming to certain hormones which are going to act as a tumor markers, like beta HCG, the most commonly used marker in gynecology and obstetric practice. The beta HCG is going to be elevated in gliocarcinoma. Normally, this beta HCG, it is measured in international units per liter. A beta HCG level of normally it should be less than 20 international units per liter. A beta HCG levels of more than 10,000 international unit per liter, definitely it's a classical thing that is going to happen in a patient suffering from choriocarcinoma or the germ cell tumors. This beta HCG is going to be elevated, and the regular frequent monitoring of beta HCG is always performed in a patient who is undergoing surgical treatment for this particular tumor. And there's something called ACTH hormone, before that calcitonin. What is calcitonin? already you have studied about the calcium balance, calcium homeostasis in our body, which are the enzymes or the, you know, the vitamins which are playing an important role in calcium metabolism. Already you are aware of it. This calcitonin is a marker which is going to be raised in medullary carcinoma of the thyroid, MTC. There are different types of cancers of the thyroid tissue. The most common cancer is papillary carcinoma of the thyroid, but there is other entity called medullary thyroid carcinoma which is going to be reflected by a tumor marker called calcitonin, which is going to be elevated in these patients. And adenocorticotropic hormone is going to reflect that the patient is suffering from lung void cell carcinoma. And there is something called apodomas. Apodomas are nothing but amino precursor uptake decarboxylation omas. In these apodomas, patients suffering from apodomas, there is a tumor marker called vasoactive intestinal polypeptide, that is VIP. It's going to be elevated. Now VMA, that is vanil mandelic acid, you are already well aware of amino acid metabolism, that is tyrosine metabolism. You have studied aromatic amino acid metabolism. What is VMA? What is its normal concentration? One should be knowing by now. This VMA is a marker for the pheochromocytoma and neuroblastoma. And 5-HIAA, that is hydroxyindoleacetic acid, is going to be raised. Please do read about tryptophan metabolism. You will understand what is HIAA and what is its role. And it's going to be raised in carcinoid tumors. What are carcinoid tumors? I'm damn sure that you will be aware of it. And the other tumor markers like tissue catabolic product like hydroxyproline, which is a constituent of collagen tissue. Collagen is made up of proline, that is hydroxylated proline, hydroxylated lysine. So this is acting one of the marker of the bone metastasis. And the serum proteins, immunoglobulins, we are going to discuss in the next class. These immunoglobulins are going to be elevated in a patient suffering from multiple myeloma, which is known as plasmacytoma, which we are going to discuss in the coming class. And macroglobulinemia. And there is something called Benson's proteins, which are going to be excreted in a patient suffering from multiple myeloma. So again, we are going to discuss in the next class about this particular aspect. So these are the various tumor markers and their importance. And look at the picture showing about the monitoring of beta HCG, like the concentration measured in nanogram per ml, but international units per liter is also used. And after certain months of treatment, initially there was raise in the initial phases, there was raise in the HCG, and after few months of treatment, there was a gross decrease in the beta HCG levels. And there is a recurrence of the tumor, again there is a shoot up of this beta HCG levels. Hence, it is this marker is used in the prognostic and diagnosis of the tumors. Now, let us discuss something about anti-cancer drugs which could be asked for maximum 3 marks or 5 marks question. The various anti-cancer drugs which are targeted against the cancer tissues are methotrexate, it is a folic acid analog. It is going to act as an inhibitor of dihydroxypolate reductase, which is required for the nucleotide synthesis. 6-mercaptopurine, it is going to inhibit IMP to AMP conversion. 6-thioguanine, we have already discussed all these things in purine chapter, the metabolites. 6-thioguanine, it is going to inhibit purine nucleotide synthesis. Cyclophosphamide, it is an alkylating agent. It causes cross-linking of bases in the DNA. It causes inhibition of the strand separation. Okay. Mitomycin C, it's an antibiotic. It causes cross-bridges between the DNA base pairs. Thus, the cell will dry. The actinomycin D is an antibiotic. It causes intercalates with the guanine bases of the DNA and is going to prevent the transcription. Next, vincristine and vinblastine, these are the alkaloids which are extracted from Vinca rosea. They interfere with the assembly of cytoskeleton and inhibits the statmokinesis, that is spindle movements. Okay, spindle movements are hampered, inhibited by this particular drugs. Adriamycin, it causes topoisomerase breakages in the DNA. Etoposide, it causes stabilization of topoisomerase 2 DNA cleavage complexes. And camptothecin, it modifies the function of topoisomerase 1 to the DNA breaking agent. Cisplatin is a platinum compound. Look at the beauty of platinum. It is used in the, it forms the intrastrand DNA adducts. Thus, can be employed as an anti-cancer drug. Imatinib is a monoclonal antibody which is going to act as a tyrosine kinase inhibitor. To understand these drugs, one has to aware of cell and its cell cycle. please do read about it, then you will be able to better understand about the mechanism of these drugs. At least 4 to 5 drugs you should be able to remember, okay, about this particular topic. Now, there's something called the great advances in the cancer treatment, you know, has been made by the monoclonal antibodies. This monoclonal antibodies are nothing but, mono means single, clone means one clone. They are the antibodies which are proliferated, produced by the single clone against the or towards the particular epitope of the antigen. Antigen has got several epitopes. These antibodies are targeted only to the particular epitope of the antigen. They are called as monoclonal antibodies. There is something called polyclonal antibodies which will be discussed later. What are these drugs? How do they act? The speciality of this monoclonal antibodies is that they act by three different mechanisms. Number one, what are they going to do to the cancer cell? First, these antibodies slowly go and bind to the cancer cell. Now, cancer cell is scared. Who is this coming and binding to me? This binding of this monoclonal antibody to the cancer cell is acting as a signal for the immune system. Our body has got a natural immune system mediated by T cells and B cells. They are going to identify this cancer cell coated with the antibody. They are going to attack them and kill them. That is one mechanism. That is how the monoclonal antibodies are targeting the cancer tissue. Number two, this cancer tissues, they are going to produce something called growth factors, which we have already discussed. These growth factors are acting as a signals for the cellular growth. For example, platelet-derived growth factor, epidermal growth factors. These monoclonal antibodies will interfere with the signals that is produced by these growth factors. They are going to block them. Now there was no more signals for the proliferation of the cell, and the cell is not going to proliferate further. That's the second mechanism how this monoclonal antibodies to act. The third mechanism, they stop the new blood vessel formation. That is called as neovascularization. Neo means new, vascularization, blood vessel growth. Cancer cells, the excessive production of these cells do require excessive blood supply. Once, if you cut down the blood supply to the cancer cells, there will not be any nutrient supply to them. The cell will automatically die. The monoclonal antibodies are going to do this job. They are going to stop the signal for the blood vessel proliferation, and the blood vessels will not come near the cancerous tissue, and there is no more new blood cell vessel formation to supply the blood to the cancer cells. Thus, the cancer cells are going to die. So this is the another mechanism how the monoclonal antibodies do exhibit. The examples of these monoclonal antibodies do include rituximab. It is the target cells are CD20 and B cells. It is going to be used in the treatment of NHL, that is non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, chronic leukocytic lymphoma, then B cell leukemia. Trastuzumab, that is the target is HER2 new protein. This HER2 is expressed by the breast tissue. HER2 protein is present in the uterine cells as well as in the breast nuclei. This breast tissue and the uterine tissue is going to express HER2 protein. Take it granted that if HER2 receptors are positive in a patient suffering from the breast, when the breast tissue, after doing FNAC of the breast, we are going to collect the breast tissue and send it for the analysis. When we send it for HER2 analysis, this HER2, if it comes positive, take it granted that the patient is definitely going to respond to this drug called trastuzumab. If HER2 is negative, this drug has no role in the breast cancer. This is the utility of this particular drug against the HER2 receptors in the breast cancer patients. Similarly, in a breast cancer patient, there are other two receptors which are expressed in the uterine and the breast tissue. That is estrogen receptors and the progesterone receptor. Again, whenever the breast cancer is diagnosed, this cancerous tissue is subjected for HER2 mutation analysis and estrogen receptor analysis and progesterone receptor analysis. If ER positive and PR, that is estrogen receptor positive and the progesterone receptor positive, comes in a breast cancer patient, definitely patient is going to respond to a drug called tamoxifen. And if the patient is negative for ER and PR, then patient is not going to respond for the tamoxifen drug. Now, there is another monoclonal antibody called bevacizumab. The target cell is, the target receptor is VEGF, that is growth factor, and it is going to be helpful in the treatment of the patient suffering from colorectal solid tumors of the kidney and the breast. And alectinib, it is the target tissue or the cells are CD52 on B cells, going to be employed in the treatment of chronic lymphoid leukemia. And cetuximab, KRAS is a receptor and it's going to be employed in the treatment of colorectal, head and neck cancer. And panitumumab, it is going to be helpful in the patient suffering from colorectal cancer. Imatinib, the target is tyrosine kinase, we already discussed in the previous slide. It's going to be employed in the treatment of chronic myeloid leukemia. This is about the various monoclonal antibodies that are employed in the treatment of the patients with the cancer. So this is about the overall aspects about the biochemistry of the cancer. One must know about the definition of the cancer, what are the statistics, which are the most commonest cancers in our country, and what is the etiology of the cancer, like various physical agents, chemical agents and the oncogenic viruses which are which are causing cancers in the human beings. And apart from that, one must know about the various properties exhibited are the by the cancer cells, like they are immortal, and there is something called tight junctions which are essential for the cell adhesion, and this phenomenon of adhesion is lost in the cancer, contact inhibition is lost. What is CLation, how this neuraminic acid residues are added to the cancer cells, and how does it act as a marker for the cancer cells, and what is apoptosis, what are the various that are genes that are mediating apoptosis, what are tumor suppressor agents, what are mutagens, and what are the drugs which are available for treatment of the cancer, that's anti-cancer drugs, which could be purine analogs, pyrimidine analogs, and the various antibiotics which could be used as anti-cancer agents, and certain monoclonal antibodies which are targeted against various cancers like colorectal, breast cancer, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, beta cell leukemia, and chronic myeloid leukemia, and CLL. So these things, so you need to remember, and in fact you need to remember about the growth factors as well, at least a few growth factors like tumor necrosis factor, transforming growth factor alpha, transforming growth factor beta. So please do remember, and epithelial derived growth factor, platelet derived growth factors, what are their role, what are the site of action. So please do remember about this, and thus we have completed this particular chapter on biochemistry of cancer. Thanks for patient listening. I'll be continuing the next class on Thursday, and I guess on Friday, with a new chapter. Thank you.